A couple of days ago, I got an email from Venerable Panavati. She's the abbess of a monastery on the East Coast, I think in North Carolina. That's where you had the monastic gathering last year, right? So last year when, I should say in 16, the autumn of 16, so both she and I were among the people who were given the Bhikshuni Award in Taiwan. So we both went to Taiwan to accept the award. And at that conference, or at that event, which lasted several days, what was the Taiwanese Bhikshuni Association became the International Bhikshuni Association. And one of the missions in it, amongst many others, was to help the spread of the Sangha, in particular in the West. Okay? And so those of us who were Western Bhikshunis, of course, you know, we spoke about that and we were very appreciative for their help and so on. So she wrote me this thing because we just got a message that there's a general meeting in Korea in April that just was announced. And so she wrote, she said, "Are you going?" And because, you know, I want to speak, I want to say something, like if they're going to help us, let's do something instead of just having lots of nice gatherings and honorary certificates. Let's actually do something. So she said, "You have a message to send, or, you know, what do you think about this?" So I was thinking about it, and I was thinking, wow, we've gotten a whole lot of help from the Chinese Bhikshunis, you know, all along. It began I first met Venerable Jendi in 1989, probably met her in a previous life, you know, because we bonded very, very much, you know, when we met. And then in 85, I went to request Venerable Wu Yin to teach at our three-week program in, not 85, 95, to teach at our three-week program in 96 in Bodh Gaya called Life as a Western Buddhist Nun. And out of that came her book, Choosing Simplicity, about the Pratimoksha, and the little pamphlet, Preparing for Ordination, for people who are preparing to ordain in the Tibetan tradition. And then also Venerable Chuni's favorite, Blossoms of the Dharma. Okay. And so that came out of that. Then when we started the Abbey here and people started ordaining here, Venerable Jendi came and Venerable Mingjia also came to be the acharya and help with the ordination. And Venerable Tiancheng, thank you. Yeah, so she came, we were translating the Pravaja ceremony and putting it in good English. And so this whole thing of cooperation began then of translating some Vinaya materials, going through previous translations, polishing them up. Now we just printed them. We have 6 Vinaya booklets out. We also publish the book on the Sangha Karmans, which was Venerable Benyon's teachings, because they introduced us to him. And we got the recordings, which Venerable Jendi transcribed, and some people translated it into English. And then there's another nun in Taiwan who helped correct the translation, and I edited the English. And so we have that book, which is really a wonderful book. You know, you should read it, because a lot of the material we're covering in the course is going to be in that book as well. And then, you know, Venerable Jendi helping materially also and encouraging other people to come here and to support the Abbey. And then now with the Living in Vinaya Living Vinaya in the West course, where we have another Vinaya course by Venerable Wu Yin, and we'll produce a book for it, and then the cooperation with Luminary Temple to publish some of Venerable Wu Yin's talks, and some of the, that I think that's one book, her talks. And then another book is one of the ones that we started to read in our morning motivations, were teachings, what is training from the point of view of her disciples, where they talk about their experiences with her. So we're on schedule. We'll cooperate to have that in English and publish that. From this course, there will come published materials. And so I'm looking, and it's like, wow, we've received a whole lot of help from the Chinese bhikshunis. Not only in terms of the Dharma, but also financially, but primarily in terms of the Dharma, which is what is really needed, to have a Sangha community and their moral support. And Venerable Hengqing also coming here, teaching the Vinaya, helping us learn how to do the Varsa and the Pravarana correctly, and then are going through the Katina, how many rewrites of the Katina ceremony we did, and understanding what that meant. I can't even count. And, I want to tell Venerable, Panavati, this is the kind of help that we've gotten, and I feel it's been just tremendous, and we're very, very grateful. And, I see it as it has nothing to do with us in particular. It has to do with their incredible wish to see the Dharma spread and flourish in the West. And to have the Dharma spread and flourish, you need the Sangha to spread and flourish. Yeah, and so with their good hearts, helping us in all these different ways, and especially with all the encouragement, Venerable Hengqing wants me to ordain people. Venerable Wu Yin pulled me aside in 16, and okay, you got to get prepared. And I'm going, no, we're training people properly, let's go slowly. But, they're amazing encouragement. Also the nuns at Puyi, when our people have gone there to take ordination, you stay there, you're welcomed, people help you. Dharma Drum, this last time the two of you were helped very much by Dharma Drum. So I feel like we have a very good relationship with the Chinese Sangha, and we're very welcome there, and they're helping us tremendously. And so I think part of that comes because we're doing something with the help that they give. Because at the beginning, whenever you start things, it's so hard because you haven't done anything. So nobody wants to support because they don't know if their support's going to go down this big deep hole and they'll never see it again. Yeah, so it's always hard, but then once you start and they can see, oh, here's people who actually do something, then, the support we've received, having Venerable Wu Yin come for this course is tremendous. And the nuns, I think part of what we've done, we were talking last night, a couple of nights ago, is because they've gotten, Luminary Temple's gotten other requests to train nuns in other traditions. So they're using this course as an opportunity to make some videos that can be distributed to other places where people are requesting help with training. So, hopefully we can continue cooperate. And from our side, we're helping with the English translations, which I think is good, so that good material is printed in English. So I'm going to write her and say, for us, no, it hasn't just been nice lunches and certificates of honor. It's been, real hands-on, ground-up help that, we wouldn't be where we are today if it weren't for the help that we received from the Chinese Sangha. So I think good for us to be aware of that and to appreciate that. Okay, I also wanted to mention that in the very early days, the first ordination we did, not only did Venerable Tien Ching come, but Venerable Kindstar and Venerable Fanaya, they were from what's the Fa Yun temple, which is in New Mexico. And so they came and helped with the first ordination, and they helped us with the first setting of the Sima, the territory. Yeah. And Venerable Weimin now has been the bhikshu that we rely on for doing our Varsa and our Pravarana ceremonies. He's from Dharma Drum. Venerable Hong Zen came one time, I think. Venerable Sintian. Yes, of course, because he came once in the early days for Venerable Jampel. He was also your preceptor, so he's the one we sent. And your preceptor in Taiwan. Both the bhikshus and the bhikshunis in the West have received a lot of help and in that way. I mean, just even giving us the ordination and trusting us with the ordination, that we wouldn't just go off and do some who knows what and declare ourselves as who knows what. Yeah, so it really involves a lot of trust, I think, to ordain people from outlying areas that you're not directly supervising. Yes. And all the people of the Chinese community, you know, including Su Wang and many of the people, you know, from Venerable Jendi's temple, you know, people coming here and cooking and the food, giving us furniture and altars and, you know, cartons of food and, you know, so much help and support. And help in building our buildings. Yeah. Yeah, so many were you know, good supportive donors of our buildings that we're very grateful for. Yeah, I'm not mentioning names there because some of the people don't like their names public. But, yeah. So we've received a lot of help. So may we use our help well.
But I think a big piece too that I found instructive for my own training is just watching how you've gone to request teachings. I mean, it's both sides, yeah? So the sincerity with which you've gone to request the teachings from masters and that they know that... And the first generation of bhikshunis here too, just knowing it's through your behavior that the trust was built. You know, that they know, okay, we're not throwing the money into a sink or this is any old who's just going to disappear. And I think it's through that trust building and seeing the ordinations happen and that the Sangha is really forming and that we're really trying our best in a not central land. I think they're very moved by that too. That's what I hear when we connect with the Chinese Sangha as well.
Yeah.
So I think that some credit has to be given to the value of your practice, the ones who have come before us.
So we're all working together for a common aim. And that's what Sangha's about, isn't it? You know, it isn't about, you know, when we look at all the things why the Buddha set up the precepts, the ultimate one, the most important one, was the sustenance of the Dharma through the generations. So we're all working together for that same purpose. And that's really, you know, why the Buddha created the Sangha. You know, you need a community of people who are practicing together to make that happen. Individuals alone cannot do it. Yeah. And holding the precepts is the essence of all of that because the precepts bind us together as well.